Last year, AMD's Ryzen really turned the PC on its head. And this year, you can think of Ryzen second generation as a bionic CPU. It's better, it's faster, it's stronger. So how did AMD make its second generation chip better? Well, one, it's on a new 12 nanometer process. And the company has gone in and taken all those rough edges on the first generation part and sanded them all off. This chip simply runs faster. Higher clock speeds, lower latencies, it all adds up to just generally better performance. Don't believe me? I took a 2700X and compared it to last year's Ryzen 7 1700X, as well as a Core i7-8700K. Yes, Intel's current top of the line consumer chip. All of them had the latest version of Windows, and yes, all of them are running with Meltdown and Spectre fixes in place. That means Intel takes a small 4-5% haircut on all performance benchmarks. Up first, Cinebench R15. In red is last year's 1700X, in green, this year's 2700X, and blue, that 6-core, not competing with the 8-core chips. You can see that green is mean and in charge. And that story pretty much runs the gamut for all multi-threaded apps. Again, compression performance, look at that great big green bar. Intel with 6 cores, just is not in the running. Even the 1700X with its 8 cores is well ahead of that Intel part. Moving on to Blender, another rendering program, the shorter bars are better, and guess what? The green bar is shorter. Again, AMD's lower latency and higher clocks are just paying off dividends. That 1700X though, interesting, not really doing that well against a 6-core chip, even though it has 8 cores. Here we are in Handbrake. Again, green is better. And no surprise, Ryzen 7, second gen, 2700X in front. 6-core blue just can't keep up. But check it out again, that 8-core 1700X with its generally low clock speeds is kind of close to that Intel Coffee Lake chip. That's not really looking good. But the good news is, Ryzen second generation in front. Avray, green, well in front. Red with its lower clock speeds, again, remember, second gen Ryzen just is gonna run at higher clock speeds than the first gen could ever dream of. Both of them still well ahead of that 6-core Coffee Lake chip. Our last chart though is Cinebench using one single thread. As you can guess, the chip with the highest clock is gonna win and Coffee Lake is well in front. On a single thread, that chip can hit 4.7 gigahertz. Versus the 4.3 gigahertz of the Ryzen second gen part, they're in front. And again, the lower clock speeds of that first generation Ryzen 1700, not looking so great. For single threaded apps, Intel still has a really good lead for performance, which is gonna affect a lot of games. Our first result is Rainbow Six Siege. You can see that Coffee Lake chip with its high clocks is in front. With its higher IPC and its higher clocks, it's pretty tough for Ryzen to compete. The good news is, Ryzen's not that far behind. Last year when Ryzen came out, there was a lot of head scratching, a lot of hand wringing. Why is it 20%, even 30% slower than Intel and a lot of benchmarks when it was so much faster in all the applications? A year later, with a newer chip, newer BIOSes, more optimized games, everything adding up to basically a faster Ryzen part means instead of being 20 or even 30% slower, we're actually really close. And again, we're running Rainbow Six Siege at 19 by 10, and all of them are well up over 200 frames a second. As much as Coffee Lake is in front, it's not in front by that much. But still, being in front means being in front. We ran Far Cry 5, brand new, ultra quality, TAA and blur on. Coffee Lake, again, in front. Decent performance lead, but look at that. In green at 106 frames a second versus 115, 19 by 10, ultra quality. You're not gonna notice it. It's actually really close. Moving on to Middle Earth, Shadows of Mordor, 19 by 10. Ultra quality, again, Intel in front, but not by a lot. Look at that, 156 frames a second versus 164. I don't know about you, but that's really not a deal breaker for me. This next slide is a hero on purpose. It's Rise of the Tomb Raider DX12 medium quality, which is a very low quality, 19x10. Intel is solidly ahead, but Ryzen, even first gen Ryzen, not that bad. The reason I'm bringing up this is last year, the Ryzen 1 probably would have been 20% slower. A lot of things have really helped get both Ryzens up a lot closer to Core i7 in gaming performance. But it's not all bad news for Ryzen in gaming. Check this out. Ashes of the Singularity, Escalation DX12, Crazy Mode, CPU focus, because we want to know how the CPU is impacting the game performance. 2700X, right there with 8700K. They're basically dead on, tied with each other. That situation wasn't the same last year. Deus Ex, Mankind Divided, DX12, 1080p, DirectX 12, ultra quality, bam, green is in front. In fact, even red is in front. We are seeing a very decent performance increase from the Ryzen parts in Deus Ex over even the mighty 8700K part. And our last slide here is Rise of the Tomb Raider. We're back again to this because I just want to show you DX12 mode, 1080p, you set it to very high and we're just dead even. Ryzen 1700, Ryzen 2700, Coffee Lake 8700K, the performance is just about dead even. That just goes to show you that at resolutions you actually play at, it really doesn't matter that much. And that's only 1080p. Once you get up to 1440p, 1600p, or 4K, it really doesn't matter that much if you have an 8700K or a 2700X. They're just gonna be the same. Besides the latency decrease, one of the big reasons AMD says they're getting all this performance is, of course, clock speed. The original Ryzen 1, which, as amazing as it was for the money, was a pretty rough part. If you ran two or three threads or four threads, it would fall off its boost speed, and it wasn't really performing that great. This new generation chip is just much better at holding higher clock speeds. To test that, I ran Cinebench using one thread all the way up to 16 threads. Here are the results, but a little hard to interpret. There isn't really the correct scale here. So I actually went ahead and figured out the percentage difference. And again, this is a Ryzen 1700X versus a Ryzen 2700X. At one thread, we're looking at 17%. Two threads, 23. Three threads, 20. Basically, for the most part, you're getting 16 to 20% performance boost from a Ryzen 7 2700X versus a Ryzen 7 1700X. Again, 16 to 20%. That is a huge increase for generation on generation in CPUs. But this really isn't about Ryzen 7 1700X versus Ryzen 7 2700X. This is really about Ryzen 7 2700X versus the mighty Core i7 8700K. We did the same thing in Cinebench from 1 to 16 threads, and here are the results. But again, it's really hard to see the scale, so again, I went ahead and figured out the percentage increase. And bam, this is still the story that we are seeing with Intel's chips versus Ryzen, even the newest Ryzen. You can see down here at the low end where we have light loads from 1 to 6 threads, Intel has a very decent double-digit advantage. And at a single thread, where it's running at 3.7 gigahertz, 14% difference. That's pretty big. But once you get up to about 7 threads, which is here, it's pretty much a tie. And here's where Ryzen 7 2700X pays off. 8%, 9%, 15%, and once you get to heavy loads, look at that. So basically, if you live down here, I've been saying this, if you live down here, all of your games, all of your applications are down here, it's not a bad idea to think about 8700K. If you don't care about price, we're gonna get into that later, but if you really do rendering, encoding, streaming games, well, playing games, and you need more cores, it's really hard to say no. I mean, that is a lot of performance you're leaving behind if you go with an 8700K. One last thing I didn't talk about was overclocking. I'm generally against trying to pass judgment on an entire series of chips from very early CPUs. I will say AMD claims, and we have done demos where we did it ourselves, that this chip should easily, for the most part, not everyone will do it, should for the most part hit low fours. 4.2 gigahertz being the point a lot of people who do want to overclock should hit. That's a good improvement over the previous Ryzen, which, as we know, was kind of a mixed bag. A lot of them overclocked decently into the high threes, but there was generally a speed of light wall at 4 gigahertz. This new one definitely gets above that, and part of that also comes to the attention AMD has paid to overclocking performance. On the screen, you can see the brand new Ryzen Master that comes with the Ryzen second generation parts. One thing that you should notice is this star. That star means that is the best core on that CCX. The circle is the second best core. So if you're gonna overclock, try to overclock those. The other two, you can just ignore them. And it's per CCX too. This is the first CCX. On the second CCX, AMD also identifies a star for the best student in class, the second best student in class with the circle, and sitting in the back row is this CPU and this CPU core. But the real secret weapon here is the included coolers. Last year, with the 1800X and 1700X, even though they were $400 and $500, you didn't get a cooler. AMD says, hey, you're gonna go out and buy your own, so you don't need ours to go into landfill. Apparently, a lot of people said, AMD, we really like your Wraith coolers, so please give it to us. So this year, every single X processor includes a cooler. At the top end, though, the 2700X gets a doozy of a cooler. It's the brand new Wraith Prism. It's rated for 124 watt TDP on the high setting and 116 watts on the low setting. And what makes it better, of course, are the lights. You get, as our video shows, you get a fan that changes color, a fan shroud that changes color, and the logo that changes color. You can change them all in three zones using a free utility, or also just plug it into your motherboard and have it run all the zones. I know you think you don't care about the cooler, but Intel's Core i7-8700K is $360 to $370 on the street, no cooler included. That means you buy this top-end consumer chip, and then you have to go out and buy a $30 or $50 cooler just to run it. With the top-end Ryzen 7 2700X, you're getting a high-end cooler, decently high-end, you can still go higher end, of course, for $330. So you're looking at an 8700K with another maybe $50 on top of it, pushing you into the low 400s versus a Ryzen 2nd Gen 8-core chip, two more cores, for almost $100 less. You get all the application performance if you do your 3D rendering, your video editing, if you're doing streaming and playing games, and you're getting damn near the same single-threaded, low thread count performance as that 8700K. I don't know about you, but I'd have a hard time saying no to all that performance on multi-threaded apps and damn near pretty close performance on low-threaded apps. And it's cheaper. Last year, Intel had some wiggle room with all that low threaded performance against first generation Ryzen. This year though, with second generation Ryzen performing as it does on the low end, AMD has pretty much closed the door on Core i7 for now. For our full review of second generation Ryzen, head on over to PCWorld.com.